here we have to calculate the pH and the concentration of F minus for this solution. First question is this a weak acid or a strong acid?
Very strong acid.
HF is a very strong acid?
No, HF is weak.
This right here. HF, weak acid or a strong acid?
Weak.
It is a weak acid. And I am asking for the pH or concentration at equilibrium of a weak acid. What do we have to do? An ice chart. Okay? Now this should not be new to you. The difference between this ice chart and the ice charts we have done before is none. Except what you put in, it might be a little different. Concentration of HF at the beginning, 0.20. That's what it reads up there, yes? What's the concentration of H plus at the beginning?
0.10.
It is not zero because this thing, this HF, is in something else. Last problem, it was the conjugate base. Now this problem is, since I am adding HCl, HCl is 100% ionized, yes? What that means is that whenever I dissolve 0.10 of HCl in water, all of it is going to become H+. Initial concentration of H+ is here 0.10. What's the initial concentration of F-?
Zero.
Zero, because it doesn't give any information there about F. But if I would have told you 0.1 of sodium fluoride, then that number you got to put it here. Yes?
Yep.
It's not sodium fluoride. It's no sodium fluoride here. But there is another concentration which you must use somewhere. This is zero. Minus X for reactants, plus X for products. Then this plus this down here. We need the Ka expression, products divided by reactants. Products is H plus divided by HF. Yes or no? Okay?
Good. Yeah.
Not very difficult. Now we are going to plug in. What am I looking for? What am I looking for? Tell me.
You're looking for the concentration of F minus.
I'm looking for the concentration of F minus. Yes?
Sulfur X. Yeah.
I'm also looking for a pH, which means I have to know the concentration of H plus.
Yeah.
Basically, I am looking for X. Yeah. I need to find what X is. I'm going to plug it in the formula and solve for X. H plus is 0.10 plus X. F minus is just X. And HF is 0.20 minus X. With our current ability, can we finish this problem? With our current ability in math, we cannot finish this problem, yes? You guys learned how to do the quadratic equation or no? You did? Okay. Well, we would have to solve for the quadratic equation, yet we are not. We are going to say that we are going to make an approximation. Because the Ka is small and the concentrations are large, the reaction goes forward very little. So the X, or the change from the concentrations you have, is small. So the approximation 0.20 minus X is more or less what? 0.20. And 0.10 plus X is more or less 0.10. And that simplifies our math. To a level that we can do, yes?
Is it always going to be in a way that we always going to use the approximation?
No. We use the approximation if Ka is small. If Ka is 10 to the minus 2, you cannot use this approximation.
About 1.36. Mm-hmm. 10 to the negative 3.
You have to use the quadratic equation. And here is 0.20 divided by 0.10, what's this X equal to?
1.36 times 10 to the negative 3.
1.36. Times 10 to the what?
Negative 3.
What's that?
That's X.
Okay, yes, a unit of molarity. What is it?
F minus.
This is X. You go here, where is X at? Here's X. That's the concentration of F minus. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to put here, that's the first answer. Concentration of F minus. I need to find the pH. And what's the pH? negative
log
of H plus. Is this H plus?
No.
No, that's not H plus.
Okay,
H plus is this. H plus is 0.10 plus 1.36 times 10 to the minus 3. What's that equal to? Two same things.
0.10.
Okay. It is the same number, yes?
Yeah.
It is the same number. That's why we were able to make this approximation here. Because it is a small number that does not change the initial number. So pH is equal to negative log of 0.1. What does that give you?
0.99.
No, the negative log of 0.1 cannot be 0.99.
One.
Yes? If you put the other number, 0.10136, yes, it would be that. Okay, guys, you got that?
Yep.
Did we do the Henderson-Hasselbeck equation last time?
We didn't do any of that.
No, we did a problem.
You just showed us. You said you're going to do it today.
We didn't do it, no.
We did not do it?
No.
Why not?
Because you said you wanted to do it for this class.
Oh. Okay. So go back to the problem you did last time, yes? Same problem. And instead of solving it the way we solved it through an ice chart, yes?
Mm-hmm.
So you put 4. And you have to notice that last problem was a problem in which I used a weak acid. Which one was the weak acid we used?
CH3COOH.
Okay, acetic acid, and there is the weak acid and its conjugate base. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
And that forms a buffer. So we can use the Henderson-Hasselbeck equation for that. Every time, can I use the Henderson-Hasselbeck equation here?
Mm-hmm.
You cannot use it, okay? Because this is not composed of, you're not putting inside a weak acid on its conjugate base, okay? So we can say, or, last problem, pKa plus the log of the base, the concentration of the base, divided by the concentration of the acid. So pH is equal to the negative log of Ka. What was the Ka?
1.8 times 10 to the minus 4.
1.8 times 10 to the minus 4.
5.
Plus the log of the base. What was the concentration of the base?
1.45.
I made up the number so I can. There's no way I'm going to remember that. 0.45 should be something that reads sodium or potassium and at the end 8. Yes?
Yeah.
What do you mean what? 0.45 is the concentration of what? Tell me the name.
Sodium acetate.
Which is called sodium acetate. Divided by what? The concentration of the acid, which was?
0.30?
Yeah. Okay, do that and tell me what number you get.
Exact frequency.
Oh. You mean these numbers? Initial numbers.
That's way better.
4.9.
How much?
4.9.
4.9, is that what you got last time from the ice chart?
Yeah.
Okay. So which equation is better to use?
That one.
The ice chart or this? This is good to use if you know you have a buffer, yes? You have a weak acid and its conjugate base, so you spend less time on it. Okay? And sometimes I'm going to force you to do the ice chart anyway by asking what is the concentration of one of the products. Okay, so you can't, at equilibrium, so you can't avoid it. These numbers in this equation are initial numbers, yes? They're not after the ice chart. They're initial numbers. Let's do a KSP problem and go to the next chapter. Now, what's KSP? Write the KSP expression for this. What's the KSP for this? The expression. Concentration of, you gotta tell me, concentration of calcium 2 plus times the concentration of F minus raised to the second power. Okay, that's the KSP. And all you need to calculate the concentration of solubility of something or the concentration is F. So calculate the solubility and concentration of F minus for that above. Write this down. When asked to calculate the solubility using KSP, find X from the ice chart, and that's the solubility. When asked to calculate the solubility through KSP, find X from the ice chart, and that's the solubility. So if you see that you have a solid on the left-hand side, and you're talking about KSP, and they ask you calculate the solubility, what are you going to find? You're going to find X from the ice chart, and that X is the solubility. Yes?
Yep.
You don't have to understand it. It is because you start here with a solid that does not have a concentration, and once you find X, that either be this number or that number, but the amount that dissolves still, X. Okay, the concentration is different, but X is the amount that dissolves. So in order to do this, what do we have to do? An ice chart. And these ice charts are the same as before, but a little different. So ice, so do I have a concentration of CaF2?
Nope.
No. There is no concentration for this, yes? Because this is a
solid.
You put a bunch in there, you put a speck or you put whatever it is, it doesn't matter how much you put. It's going to be the same. So, what is the concentration of calcium 2 plus initially?
Zero.
Do you see anywhere where it says calcium anywhere?
No.
No.
Nope.
No concentration of calcium anywhere. In fact, no concentration at all of anything. So this looks weird, yes? When you look at it, you're like, oh, this is not enough information. How about F minus? Any concentration of F minus?
No.
No. So that's a zero. Change here is plus X, and change here is plus 2X. This is X, and this is 2X. I'm going to write what this KSP, oh, did I give it to you? KSP is 3.9 times 10 to the minus 11. Is that small or what?
Pretty damn small.
That's very small, yes?
Yep.
Oof. KSP is equal to concentration of 2 plus times concentration of F minus raised to the second power. I'm going to plug those X's in because I need to find X.
So X times 2X squared.
3.9 times 10 to the minus 11. Concentration of calcium is X. And what's the concentration of F minus? Look here. F minus is 2X. So I'm going to say 2X squared. And 2X squared is not 2X squared, yes? 2X squared is not equal to 2X squared, right?
Of course.
What is it equal to?
4X
squared. Okay, outstanding. Apparently you guys took that math class, didn't you? So, 3.9 times 10 to the minus 11. How much you bet some of you forget about that 4? You want to bet? That's equal to?
Won't be mean.
X and X squared, that's X to the third, and the 2 squared for X cubed. You agree?
Yes.
So now we are going to find this X, which is very fun to do it in the calculator. This is X to the third power divided by 4. This is the cube root, and here is the cube root. Do you know how to find the cube root on your calculator?
Yeah. Yep.
Do you know how to find the fourth or the fifth root? Huh? Do you know how to find the fourth and the fifth root?
Yeah.
Okay. How?
You raise it
you
to
raise
the
it
negative,
to
the one, fifth, or whatever.
Okay, alright.
There's the button that lets you change the number.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Don't say that.
Some calculators don't have a button that lets you change the number.
Try a different calculator.
Then as when you start bumping into things, you're going to be buying calculators all the time. God throws you lemons, you got to make...
Thank you.
You gotta make ceviche, man. So, what's next?
Find X.
No, but tell me what the number is.
3.4.
3.4.
No.
Times 10 to the negative 4.
It's 2.1 times 10 to the negative 4.
What? Navarrete is spreading the disease, yes?
It's 2.14 times 10 to the negative 4.
2.14 times 10 to the minus?
Oh, 4.
Negative 4.
Oh.
Yes.
It's
spreading
it's okay,
disease.
Man. It shocked me too when I noticed I was wrong.
What was it?
2.1 times 10 to the minus. You didn't get it, don't lie. You just wrote the number in. You did not get it. Okay, so this is equal to molarity, yes?
Yeah.
Yes or no? Now we go here, and what's the concentration of calcium 2 plus? The concentration of calcium 2 plus, even if it's not asking us for this, concentration of calcium 2 plus is equal to what? 2.14 times 10 to the minus 4 molarity. What is the solubility? The solubility is 2.14 times 10 to the minus 4 molarity. That's solubility. And what's the concentration of F minus?
2 times the number we just found.
Hmm? Concentration of F minus, here is F minus, yes or no? You go down here, concentration of F minus is 2x. This is 2x. So the concentration is 2 times 2.14 times 10 to the minus 4. What's that equal to?
4.27.
4.27?
Yep.
You multiply 2 times 2.14 and you get 4.27.
4.28 times 10 to the negative.
Your math is, I mean, you want it, I understand what you did, okay? I'm just trying to give you a hard time. But anyone that looks at this and sees 4.27 is gonna be like, what? Mm-hmm. So this is 4.28 maybe, yes? Mm-hmm. Times 10 to the what?
Negative 4.
What?
Molarity.
Very good. Do you expect one like that on the test?
I hope so.
I'm not gonna lie to you, 100% guaranteed. And one like the one I'm gonna do next. I have never missed this on the test. Yeah.
That 2x squared comes because the 2 goes in front of the x and it's squared.
Yes. Okay. Now, how many times did I use this 2 here? I used the 2 here, didn't I? This 2 here. I used it here to square. I used it here and I squared it again. Mm-hmm. And I used it here again. I used this 2-3 times. Now you on the test are gonna go, oh man, this is, I'm using this 2 all over the place. No, let's erase this one.
No.
Let's erase this one.
You don't square the
You just erase 2 that
way?
No, you don't square. The concentration is not squared. I mean, it's not squared here. It was squared to find x. Let's do another. Calculate the solubility of CaF2 in 0.010 molarity calcium nitrate. ASP here is, what was the number? 3.9 times 10 to the minus 11.
Common iron, this is what it
says. I don't know, you try to do the problem.
Calcium nitrate has that initial molarity with calcium 2 plus.
I have no idea.
Yeah, that's why. You don't have nitrate, but you have calcium.
Okay. Let's do it, guys, okay? Alright. Ready? What is this? I am asking for the solubility of a solid given KSP. What do we have to do?
Ice chart.
And from this ice chart, I'm gonna have to find x. So I'm going to do the famous ice chart. This is a solid. Does it have a concentration? No. So what's the concentration of calcium plus at the beginning?
Well,
at the beginning, I give you concentration of something. Okay. And when you look here, the only thing that is common to this is what? The nitrate. You see nitrate here anywhere?
No.
So that doesn't do anything to. It does give you nitrate, but it's not part of the equilibrium, so it doesn't matter. Plus, it's a conjugate base of a strong acid. Mm-hmm. It's always soluble. Solubility rules in 1045. So calcium is what? It's here.
Yep.
What's this concentration? 0.10 molar. What's the concentration of that
zero.
Minus?
Zero.
Zero. How do you know it's zero?
Because it's not spoken of.
But if I would have told you and a concentration of 0.0135 of potassium fluoride.
Then we'd have
it.
Then you have to put this number here, yes? But that's not what happened, so don't write it. And this is plus x, and this is plus 2x. 0.0110 plus x, and this is 2x.
Yep.
Yes or no?
Mm-hmm.
And now we are going to find this the same way we have been finding it for at least a month, yes? I don't feel like doing this anymore, but...
How can people not get ice charts the entire time?
How can people not get ice charts? Because there are people that don't try. That's what happens. There are people that don't care about my class. They don't care about their future. This is the only reason why they don't understand it. Everyone in here has enough brain neurons to process this information. So what's the next thing to do? KSP is equal to concentration of calcium 2 plus, concentration of F minus, raised to the second power, yes? I will write these numbers in. 3.9 times 10 to the minus 11 is equal to calcium plus is 0.010 plus x, and this is
2x
squared.
Yeah.
I cannot follow with this difficulty, this degree of difficulty in this class. So I am going to say 0.010 plus x. I'm going to deal with this later. I'm just going to say this is 4x squared before I forget the 4. The answer, if you forget the 4, is on the test in case you want to get it wrong. I'll give you that opportunity. Now, what am I going to do here?
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to do an approximation here. I'm going to do an approximation because
KSP
is small. Because the KSP is small, the initial concentration did not change by much. If it's not small, what do you do?
Quadratic
equation. If you don't know how to do the quadratic equation, that is your problem. I'm not a math professor. I can't teach you the quadratic equation. Because I have a pseudo disability. You agree?
Yep.
Is that good? I am solving for us, aren't I?
So you bring it over.
So 3.9 times 10 to the minus 11 divided by 0.010.
Square root
and
divide it again.
Divided by 4. And this is x squared, square root there, square root here. X is equal to what?
3.12 times 10 to the negative 5.
Okay, let's say 3.1 times 10 to the minus 5. And the units on that are?
Yeah.
Molarity. So, once again, what am I looking for? The solubility. Is this a solubility? Yes, this is the solubility. If I wanted the concentration of F minus, how much would it be?
Two times that.
6.1, yes? 6.1 times 10 to the minus 5, according to your calculations from last time. Okay. You are going to remind me of this.
What?
That I'm going to say to you.
Okay.
You're going to remind me to do acid-base titrations math. We're not going to do this now. We're going to do it later.
I heard the math is a pain.
No.
We'll see you later. You mean like by the end of the class or like next class?
Next class.
Okay.
Okay, we're going to go to the next chapter. The next chapter is called entropy. Okay? I should have sent you the slides, didn't I? Entropy is letter S. Guys, we have an exam next week. On Thursday, up to this point. Got it?
Up to that point?
Up to that point. What I'm going to do now is not on the test.
And thirdly, what will the chapters be? What are the chapters that we're going to...
Chapters are acid basis and acid-base equilibria, which is this stuff that I did last. This, not on the test, on the final exam. Entropy is letter S. And it relates to the state of disorder of a system. State of disorder. There are three laws in thermodynamics. First law of thermodynamics you had in 1045, at least in this campus or in this school. First law of thermodynamics says what?
No.
Energy. Yeah, no, that's fine. Energy cannot be created nor destroyed. You're right. Energy. Energy cannot be created nor destroyed. That's true. Energy can only be transformed. Mathematical equation for that is the change in energy is equal to Q plus W, yes?
Mm-hmm. I remember that.
You had that in 1045, didn't you?
Yes.
Okay. You had an equation for Q and equation for W. That's in the past now. We are going to do the second law of thermodynamics, which has to do with this entropy thing. Second law of thermodynamics says that the entropy is not conserved. Okay, the entropy of the universe is increasing. So what's happening to the organization of the universe? Is getting organized or disorganized?
Disorganized?
It's getting disorganized. So do you expect your life to get into order at some point in your life?
Nope.
No, do not expect that. You are just setting yourself for a disappointment. From now, it's just going to get worse, okay? Get ready. Entropy of the universe. Not conserved. So... the entropy of the universe is increasing. You can say one way, you can say the entropy of the universe is not conserved. You can say the entropy of the universe is greater than zero. You can say that the entropy of the universe is increasing. You can say the disorder of the universe is increasing. It's all second law. Yes? Third law. Of thermodynamics says that the entropy of a perfect crystalline substance at absolute zero. Absolute zero is a temperature, yes?
Mm-hmm.
What temperature is that?
Zero Kelvin.
And I write that zero like that, and I put a... so you know that it's not okay. Some of you will say, some of you have come to the office and, Professor, what do you mean by okay? Okay, what? Like Oklahoma? Okay, this is zero Kelvin. It's equal to zero. Wow. That's crazy.
Wait, that's the end of it? That was like you can't reach out to zero. Like that's, shouldn't that be the law? Like you can't reach out to zero.
You're always confused, man.
It's in the book.
Because he took it in high school.
Oh, because you took it in high school, and in high school they talk about all this stuff that can't be done or cannot be done. Everything can be done. Smoke something and you'll find out soon enough. All right. So what this says, at zero Kelvin, yes? Absolute entropy is equal to zero. And that is called a definition. Okay, is that clear?
Yep.
That's a definition. Now, is anything at absolute zero? Is the temperature anywhere on the universe at zero Kelvin?
No.
Nowhere. Okay? So, does any substance have an absolute entropy of zero? No. All substances are above zero. So, all substances have some type of entropy. Yes? Because the only time that is zero, absolute entropy, okay? I'm not talking about change in entropy. I'm talking about absolute entropy. All right. So that does not happen. What's the background temperature of the universe? You don't know?
No, I don't know.
No? Why not? Now, in the absence of a heat source, what should be the temperature?
Zero.
Hello?
Zero.
Zero, right? I mean, if nothing is heating the thing, it's supposed to have the lowest temperature, yes? Which is zero. But the temperature of the universe is not zero. It's like from 3 to 4 Kelvin.
Okay? It's radiating heat
naturally
or something.
Why is the universe hot?
The inner core?
The universe is hot from the initial explosion. It's called background temperature, background radiation.
Billions of stars.
They emit light.
So the sun isn't hot.
The sun is hot, but it's not. It doesn't heat the entire universe.
But there's billions of suns.
They don't heat the entire universe. The entire universe is a little bigger than the sun. Okay. Anyway, that's how it is.
Physics.
Okay? It was called the Big Bang.
Yeah.
You seen the show?
Yep. Yes.
Nerds with a hot girl.
Yeah. I love that show. It's so great.
Okay. So one of those three or two of those three will be on the test. Okay. Simple.
As definitions.
Yeah. As definitions. You have to memorize the definitions. Okay. Now, when something leads to a disorder, is that a good thing or is that a bad thing?
Usually a bad thing.
When something leads to a disorder, it's a good thing. Your mom might think it's a bad thing if you have your room all messed up. But it's a good thing for the universe. Okay? That is a natural law. Everything goes from organized to disorganized. So things that lead to a greater disorder or become disorganized is a preferred event. Yes? So how easy is it for you to disorganize your room?
Very easy.
So easy, you can't even feel that you're disorganizing it, yes? But what do you have to do to organize it?
Put work into it.
You gotta work, yes? And that's difficult. That's something you don't want to do. Okay? So that's a natural thing, is to become messed up. And to organize it, you gotta do work. You gotta go against the system. So here, I'm going to ask you, does the entropy increase or decrease? So we're gonna say, change in entropy for this process greater than zero, that means that the entropy did what? Increased. If it is, the entropy is less than zero, what happens to the entropy? Decreased. Or the entropy can be more or less close to zero. But it will probably not be zero. Now, there are times in which the entropy will increase. I'm going to write on the board, before I do the problem, I'm going to write on the board how the entropy increases. They increase like this. When you go from a solid to a liquid, what happens to the entropy? It increases. Why?
Because all the particles are moving around.
Because all the particles are
moving more
than they were before. So the entropy will increase for the following events. From solid to liquid, the entropy increases. From liquid to gas, does the entropy increase?
Yes.
Yes.
From
a solid.
There's more collision, right?
What?
There's more collision of molecules.
Yeah, but no, it's about the disorganization. In a gas, the molecules are
everywhere. Okay.
Messy. When you have a solid and it becomes something ionized, or when you have a solid and dissolves, entropy increases. When the temperature increases, the entropy increases, yes? The higher the temperature, the higher the entropy, because the messier the molecules are. And I'm going to say something here. The more moles you have, the larger the entropy. And that's kind of weird, okay? But if you have 2 moles of a gas, or if you have 100 people, what's messier, 100 people or 2,000 people? 2,000 people. You can't control 2,000 people, yes? Unless you give them beer. So, and more bonds. The more bonds you have, the higher the entropy, because the molecules store energy on those bonds. As you had in IR for the beginning of this course, like bending, stretching, translating, those are ways of storing energy.
What about volume? Do a greater volume equal greater entropy or not?
Yeah, but it depends what you have inside of that volume.
It's not necessarily.
Not necessarily. We don't talk about volume, okay? So, but yes, if you have the same amount of substance and you make the volume bigger, the entropy will increase, yes. So I'm going to give you an example next to it. You write, if this is the case, that's the case, so that's the case. Ready? H2O liquid. Did entropy increase or decrease?
Increase.
Entropy, what?
Increase, up.
Entropy increased, of course. Entropy increased. How about that? These are ions, and they precipitate. They form a solid. Not good at all. This entropy decreased. Does that mean that it doesn't happen? Does that mean that it doesn't happen?
No.
That doesn't mean that.
Does it mean you put energy into the system?
It could. You could.
So the molecules become more organized in a solid.
But sometimes the reaction is exothermic, and it's not only about entropy, it's about other things as well. So we're going to talk about this later. How about that? Okay, I had a gas here. Do I have a gas on this side?
No.
The gas became a solid. Solid, right? Not much change there. But a gas
disappeared, went away.
So this is less than zero.
Professor, what about the number of moles?
Yeah, man. You mean what about the number of moles there? Not important. Because a gas became a solid.
Okay. So let
me look at the states.
Because a gas is a bigger effect. Let me see if I can find the notes I recently wrote 10 years ago. Oh, here they are. Calcium carbonate gives you calcium oxide plus CO2 gas. What about that? Entropy increased or decreased?
Increased.
From a solid, I got a gas, yes? I also have a solid, but it doesn't matter. These are more or less comparable. But you form the gas, so this is?
Increased.
Increase in entropy.
No, because there's more moles of gas before than after, so entropy decreased.
Okay, so here, when you look at it, you can find, you go, no solid to gas, no liquid to gas. Okay, everybody's a gas. Now I gotta count how many gas molecules I have.
So there's
I have four gas molecules here. And how many gas molecules here? Two. So I lost how many gas molecules? I lost two gas molecules. Entropy decreased, yes? So that means it became more organized, yes? We're not gonna say zero, yes? We're not gonna say zero. We're gonna say two gas molecules here, two gas molecules here. The entropy for this will be more or less zero. That means that it could be a little bit greater than zero. It could also be a little bit less than zero. We don't know. That depends on the bonds of these things. Okay? We can calculate this. We will in a second. Yes or no?
Yep.
So determine, of these two pairs that I'm going to give you, which one has higher entropy. I'm going to give you two things for you to compare, and you tell me which one would have higher entropy. One mole of sodium chloride, or one mole of HCl. Which one would have a higher entropy?
HCl.
Higher entropy will be HCl, because HCl is a
gas.
Okay, very good. That was easy, yes?
Yep.
So let's say this is one. So which one?
Two moles
of HCl. That's a lot more. This is a difficult one here.
It's HCl
because HCl has one bond while argon does not have bonds. The more bonds you have, the higher the entropy, yes? Keep your thoughts to yourself. Damn. Which one is it?
Kelvin.
Which one?
Kelvin.
First or second?
Second.
Yeah, after he messed it up, right? Second, because 25 degrees Celsius is 298 Kelvin, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Yes? There is no problem. Is there a problem with 25 Kelvin?
It's really cold.
It's really cold? The boiling point of liquid nitrogen is 77 Kelvin.
So you put your hand in liquid nitrogen, it'd be cooled down to 77 Kelvin, which is how much?
Negative two something.
Let's say around 190 degrees Celsius, minus 190 degrees Celsius.
And that's so, like minus 35 in a guy, so yeah, man.
Minus 35?
It gets minus 40 sometimes.
So how do you make liquid nitrogen?
You don't make liquid nitrogen. Liquid nitrogen is already made.
Where do they get it?
80% in the environment. 80% nitrogen. You get it, you compress it, it becomes a liquid. Just like oxygen, yes? You don't make oxygen, you just get it from the one that's already there. Okay, guys. You want to do some more math, yes? You guys love math.
Yes.
Okay, we can calculate the change in entropy of a system like this. Change in entropy of a system is equal to the Q reversible, or the heat reversible, divided by the temperature at constant temperature. Does this cause a problem?
No, you're the minister.
What did you say?
What does that mean? Q reversible.
Q? What's Q? Heat, yes? Reversible heat. Reversible. You guys don't know what reversible is, do you? Do you know what irreversible is? When you die, is that reversible?
So it's basically heat that can be cooled down? Is that what it is?
When you die, that's irreversible, okay?
That's reversible.
Because
you
what, you were dead for 5 seconds?
Or 20 seconds.
Technically, there's a phenomenon that some people die for like 2 minutes and then they come back.
Yeah.
That's debatable.
Yeah, 4 and 5 minutes.
That happened to my grandma.
I don't think you... You were not dead yet, okay? When you are pronounced dead, that's when you're dead, yes? When the doctor said, the person died, now you go to the grave, yes? Or you go to the place where they're going to burn you. Or feed you to the crocodiles. I suggest donating your body to science. I'm donating mine to science. When I die, they come get me, take me to some medical school. So if you get me in medical school, give a shout out. You have my permission to take a picture with my dead body. Post it on Facebook and say last goodbye to Garcia. Let's open him up, see what he got. Alright. So Q reversible is the amount of heat reversible. Maybe we don't know what it is, but reversible means he can go back and forth along the same path. Write it down. Reversible, back and forth along the same path. You'd never guess what irreversible is. Violeta, what do you think? Irreversible, if reversible means back and forth along the same path, can go back and forth. Irreversible means cannot go back and forth. Very good. So here I'm going to give you a little example. I wasn't planning on doing it, but you provoked it. Let's say here we have a removable barrier. I can bring this up, I can bring it down. On this side, there is a piston that I can push. On this side of this container, I have a gas. I have gas on this side of this container. There's no gas on this side. I get this barrier and I lift it up. Yes? And when I lift this barrier up, piston's still here. When I lift this barrier up, what did the gas do? Expand, yes?
Isn't that what happens inside a turbine of a car?
In the what?
Inside of the pistons of a car. Like,
well, inside the piston of a car, there is an explosion.
Mm-hmm.
And the explosion, the expansion of the gas moves this thing. So it's a little different.
It goes forward first, right? And then it forces the explosion.
What?
It goes forward instead of backwards, right?
Yeah, it goes to a little volume with the gas inside, and then the spark, it explodes, and it moves the piston back. When it moves the piston back, it moves the irons inside of the thing, which translates into the wheels moving. Don't worry, okay? So the gas expands. A reversible process would be, what did I do there? Lift the barrier, yes? And if this is reversible, when I bring the barrier down, do all the gas molecules go this way?
No.
No. So this process will be
irreversible.
Irreversible because you cannot go back along the same path. So it has to be described to you, yes? For you to be able to tell if you can go back and forth. Okay? Now, can I go back to what I used to have before? Yes. I can get this piston and push this piston this way until all the gas is once again here. But what did I have to do in order to go against this process that was irreversible? I had to apply work. Okay? So normally, irreversible processes lead to an increase in entropy. Okay? And irreversible processes are in general spontaneous. What's a reversible process? One that can go back and forth along the same path, yes? The only example I care about you knowing is reactions at equilibrium can go back and forth along the same path. And another example you're going to know is this one now. What happened?
No, I was wondering if they were going to give the energy.
What?
They were going to give the energy.
Yeah. What?
No, I just wanted to.
Okay.
The irreversible process leads to an increase in energy in what?
Spontaneous. So, now, for this to be true, this process needs to be reversible. I am going to use the heat used for that. And the temperature needs to stay constant. And I will divide by that temperature, which is constant. It's not change in temperature, it's the temperature at which this process took place. This equation we're going to use for a phase transition. Is the temperature constant at a phase transition?
Yes.
Temperature is constant at a phase transition. Now, when water is boiling, at what temperature does it boil? At 100. Water boils at 100, so the temperature is constant at that temperature. So we just need to see the amount of heat. That process is reversible. So this will be converted to this. Delta S of the system at a phase transition, Q reversible is equal to delta H. There is only two types of delta H. There is either delta H of fusion and delta H of vaporization that I'm going to give you on the test. So either delta H of fusion or delta H of vaporization. Fusion is as you go from solid to a liquid, and vaporization as you go from the liquid to the gas, yes? So the delta S of the system becomes this delta H of fusion or vaporization divided by the temperature. This is at a phase transition, so our constant temperature. So let's say calculate the entropy of H2O at its boiling point. The boiling point of water is what? 100 degrees Celsius, yes. Delta H of vaporization is 40.67 kilojoules per mole.
By the way, units of entropy. Write it down. Units of entropy are joules. Per Kelvin. But do they depend on the number of moles too? Mm-hmm. Yes or no? So since you have to determine, since you have to say it for the number of moles, and you have number of moles, you lose the moles. So it's joules per Kelvin. If you don't have the number of moles, then it will be joules per mole per Kelvin. So what are we going to do here? So the delta S of the system, which is the water boiling, yes? By the way, do you know what a system and the surroundings is? System is under study. Write it down. System is whatever you are studying. Surroundings is everything outside of that. So the delta S for the boiling of this water is equal to Q reversible divided by temperature. That's got to be a class in funeral service.
Celebrating the irreversible process.
That's right. Okay, so the S, the delta S of the system is equal to the delta H of vaporization divided by the temperature, yes? So our delta S will be, where's the delta H of vaporization? 40.67 kilojoules per mole, yes? Divided by the temperature. What's the temperature? 100?
No, 373.
Why can't I use 100?
It's Kelvin.
Because I told you that the unit was Kelvin? No. Why can't we use?
Because it's not the unit, it's not the correct unit.
No, I said if I would have never told you you had to use Kelvin, how would you know I have to use Kelvin?
It's not the correct unit for entropy.
What?
It's not the correct unit for entropy.
No, that's what I said. If you don't know the units of entropy, how do you know it can be Celsius or Fahrenheit? There's a reason for that, which I have been trying to explain since 1025.
It's the absolute.
The problem with this is that the entropy, does the sign of entropy matter? If it's positive or negative, does it matter?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If it's positive, it means disorder increased, yes? And if it's negative, it means the order increased. So is it possible that I have a minus 35, like in Canada, degrees Celsius, and that changes the sign of my equation, yes or no?
Yep.
So the reason why you don't use Celsius is because Celsius has negative signs and okay. Kelvin doesn't. So we used Kelvin because a negative sign would not be produced here. That's why the Kelvin scale exists. Divided by the temperature in Kelvin, what is it? How much? 373. You sure it's not like 372?
It's 0.15.
373 Kelvin? Okay, and that will be in kilojoules, yes? We don't want kilojoules, we want joules. So joules on the top, kilojoules on the bottom. 1 kilojoule is 10 to the third. So the kilojoules were canceled with the kilojoules. I have joules. Tell me the answer to this. 107.
Did you get it?
I'm not going to lie to you. I don't think it's
107.
What is that? I mean, you guys guessed that right. There's no way he can get this right. What's the number?
109.
Oh. What do you mean, excuse me? I mean, 107 is different from 109, is it not?
Yeah.
Even more if you punch them numbers in the calculator.
You're sitting at home tripping out.
109 what?
Joules.
You giving birth right now? Unfortunate. So, joules, yes? Joules. Mole. Kelvin. Okay. But this has something to do with the moles, yes? So, if I don't give you information about the moles and you give it to me like this, it's okay. But if I tell you I have 1 mole of water doing this, then the number will be 109, yes? You multiply 1 mole, so the moles cancel out, yes? But if I have 2 moles, then the entropy would be, don't let him answer it.
Like how can we try?
So if you have 2 moles, how much would it be?
2 times.
Let's round it to an easy number, 110, yes? So if I have 2 moles, it would be 220, okay? Because 109, multiplying 109 by 2 is tough. Okay. You want another one, or is that good for you?
Let's go.
That's one, you got that one on the test as well.
All right.
It's the last question on the first page of the final exam, which I wrote recently.
Like your notes?
Like my notes, yeah. I don't want to do that for all that.
Well, do it if you have to know it. And this is just expanding on what we did in 1045?
No, this is entropy. It has nothing to do with 1045.
We did delta H reaction.
Yeah, delta H. So, let's say parade reaction. Like you did in 1045, yes? Delta H in 1045 was what? Delta H of a reaction. It was products minus reactants, yes? In this case, we're going to calculate delta S over a reaction, and that will be equal to products minus reactants.
What is this?
The worst of all is that we're going to also calculate delta G for a reaction, and delta G is called Gibbs free energy. And delta G, or Gibbs free energy, and I'm going to talk about that more in a minute, is also equal to products minus reactants. Where do you get these numbers for the products, and where do you get the numbers for the reactants? You get them from a table. Okay? This thermodynamic data. And this table I'm going to give you on the test. This table is going to have way, way, way more numbers than you need. You're going to have to search for the numbers you are going to use depending on the reaction. Yes? What time is this class over?
20 minutes.
20 minutes?
Yeah. Speaking of which, do you have the grades for the test?
I do have the grades for the test, but I don't think I'm going to give them back today.
Why?
Yeah, I'm going to give it to you, okay? When I finish talking about this, I'll give it to you outside. Okay, so let's say nice. Oh, you have a test next week. calculate delta S, and that zero on the top means under standard conditions, okay? Under standard conditions is 298 Kelvin. It's not like standard conditions from STP of gases, which is zero Kelvin. 1 atm, blah, blah, blah. So this zero here means what? Under standard conditions. For the following.
So which temperature is it?
298 Kelvin.
What happened? What did you say?
You said 28 Kelvin.
28 Kelvin. Okay, my friends. So we want to calculate the delta S under standard conditions for this reaction, and it will be products minus reactants. But as we know that it's not good enough for us, we gotta say the summation of the moles.
I remember this.
Of the products minus the summation of the moles of the reactants. So
you hate it? What do you mean you don't hate it?
How can you hate something that you gotta do?
You just gotta do it. You gotta like it.
Do you hate it when it rains?
That M after the summation of moles as well?
Yeah, moles, moles. So
if you have to eat, then yeah.
So let's say this is what we have, products, yes? And I am going to use 2 moles. Yes or no?
Yep.
Because in front of these two products I have a 2. 2 moles, and I am going to use the entropy under standard conditions of NH3. Where am I going to get this number from?
A charge.
I am going to get this number from?
A charge.
A table. And who is going to give you this table?
You. Man in purple.
Me. If you don't have me, then who's going to give you the table?
Google
is going to give you the table. Google, I mean... You could have said the book, yes? The book has it. So this is minus.
Parentheses.
Minus? No, I don't like parentheses. Reactants get a minus, yes or no?
Yep.
Minus reactants. Here is how many moles? 1 mole of the entropy of, or change in entropy of, and to the number from the table. Yes.
And minus again.
And minus, because it's also a reactant, yes? The other one, which is 3 moles of the entropy of H2.
Yeah.
Guys, did you write down that I get these numbers from a table? Which you can go and look for yourself right now. You can Google it. I'm just not going to Google anything. I recently wrote it, but you know. So, 2 moles times the entropy of NH3. The entropy of NH3 is 192.5 joules per mole Kelvin. Minus 1 mole of the entropy of N2, which is, is it 191 or is it 91?
You want me to check?
I think it's 191.6 joules per mole Kelvin minus 3 moles of H2. What is it for H2? 130.7 joules per mole Kelvin.
Moles cancel out, really.
Okay, so the moles cancel out.
get a number.
What number do you get? What? Guys, you allowing him to say the answer? How does it feel, huh? To stick your fingers in their calculator and get it wrong.
It must be mental now.
I saw he put the numbers and he gave me the wrong answer.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yes, I'm not even gonna change the calculator.
And you haven't changed it, and you have been wrong the entire semester. Now is what I want to change. Don't change it anymore, just leave it.
So how did you ever pass any of the tests if your calculator
didn't?
No, because
he did. Gives it a closed answer.
You asked, how do you pass the test? And he didn't.
I mean, if the calculator's not working, I don't know.
Okay. So, what is it? What's the number?
Negative
198.7. What?
Joules per Kelvin.
Joules per Kelvin. Okay, because I had the moles were not used. The process was, did the entropy increase or decrease with this process? Decrease. Is that what you expect? From 4 moles of a gas, you have 2 moles of a gas. So that's not good. Why don't you do for homework? Here, I'm going to give you homework for delta G. I'm not going to do delta G, okay? That's too much work. Too much work noise, the same as this. I'm not going to continue wasting time. So calculate delta G for the reaction. And this is the reaction that I'm going to give you. P4 gas plus 6 CO2 gas gives you 4 BCl3 gas. The answer, meaning I'm giving you the answer, yes, but when you do it, you check. If you did it right, of course. He is not going to be able to check. He's going to do it and he's going to go, oh no, he did it wrong. Professor did it wrong. This is the answer. Delta G, you never guess, is given in what units? Kilojoules per mole.
Why?
What do you mean why? It's like, why do people weigh themselves in pounds? Why?
Yeah.
A lot of people know in kilos. I don't know why.
Okay, so why do people weigh in kilos then?
So they can feel skinny.
Hmm?
So they can feel skinny.
So they can feel skinny?
It's a small number. Yeah.
Okay. This is the way it is. In general, delta G, since you want to know, delta G are large numbers, okay? So large numbers, kilojoules is a preferred unit for that. Energy and entropy are smaller numbers, so we use a smaller unit.
Okay.
Okay?
But what is delta G? What does it mean?
It's
more
energy.
What does it do? What is it?
What does it do?
What is Gibbs free energy?
You mean who is Gibbs?
What is delta G?
He's screwing with you so bad.
Okay, so I'm going to give you another equation for delta G, okay? Delta G, because he can't understand math, yes? Delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Gibbs is the final word whether something is spontaneous or not. Gibbs is the total amount of energy of any system. You had before delta H, yes? And delta H referred to what before? Hello? Heat, yes? You also had delta S before. What does that refer to?
Entropy.
Entropy. And now we are combining the two to get delta G. If delta G is less than zero, the process is spontaneous. If delta G is greater than zero, the process is non-spontaneous. Yes, if delta G is less than zero, write it, guys. No. Look, this is how you write delta G less than zero. Delta G less than zero. Spontaneous. Delta G more than zero. Non-spontaneous. And delta G is equal to zero. Equilibrium.
So it can actually be equal to zero.
Yes, it can.
Okay, so if I have things under standard conditions, I'll get a zero here, a zero there, and a zero there. If it is under standard conditions, it doesn't have to be under standard conditions. Now, what we want is what? For things to be spontaneous or non-spontaneous. What do you prefer? Spontaneous, yes? So the purpose of what we are going to do next is to make things spontaneous. So, let's say that we are going to manipulate the signs of these two things to make this spontaneous. What sign are we looking for spontaneous? Negative, yes? So let's say that the delta H is a good thing. What's a good thing for delta H?
Small.
That is a sign.
This one.
I mean, exothermic is better, yes? Endothermic requires heat, yes? Exothermic releases heat. You don't need anything for exothermic.
For endothermic, you need to apply heat. So a good thing for delta H is exothermic, and the sign for that is negative. Now, this is going to be complicated for some of you, okay? We have a negative, and I am going, it's a number here, yes? And I am going to, this is not a multiplication of these two negatives, this is an addition of these two, yes? Now, what's a good thing, and in parentheses I'm going to write what that is. What's a good thing for delta S?
Positive.
Positive is a good thing. So here we have a case in which we have a negative number and we add another negative number. What are we always going to get? We are always going to get something that is negative or something that will be spontaneous. And it will be spontaneous at all temperatures. These are questions on the test. But if you don't understand, you better ask. So we made both of these things a good thing, yes? We made the preferred exothermic, preferred entropy increases, yes? Let's make these both a bad thing. What's a bad thing for delta H? Endothermic, yes, which is positive. And this is a negative here. It's an addition once again. And now let's make the delta S a bad thing too. What is it? Negative. So a negative times this negative gives you a positive. And a positive added to another positive will always be positive. So this is always positive, and it is non-spontaneous. At what temperatures? At all temperatures. If the forward process is non-spontaneous, the reverse will be spontaneous, okay? They're the reverse of each other. One spontaneous, the other one is non-spontaneous. Okay, let's do a tug of war. You know what a tug of war is?
Yep.
Someone pulls, someone wins, yes? Let's make this a good thing. Let's make this negative. Just so it looks prettier if we jump from sign to sign, yes? So we make this a what? A good thing. There's a minus there. And let's make this a bad thing. What's a bad thing for this delta S? A negative. Negative is a bad thing. It leads to more order, yes? So a minus times a minus gives you a positive. Which number do you want to be bigger? This. You want this number to be bigger, yes? Because the idea is to get this to be spontaneous, yes? To be negative. So if I want this to be negative, this number has to be what?
Small.
Smaller than this one. And for this number to be small, since you can't change this, what has to be small is this. So this will be spontaneous at what type of temperatures? Low or high temperatures?
Low temperatures.
Low temperatures, because we are trying for this number to be small. I can't change this one. The only one that I can change is this one. the lower the temperature, the smaller this number will be. Yes or no?
Yes.
Guys, yes or no?
Yes.
So this will be spontaneous. When?
At low temperatures.
Spontaneous at low temperatures.
Because you're solving for delta S, right?
We're not solving for delta S, it's delta G. We want delta S to lose this battle. Okay, let's do the other case. These are on the test, my friends. So, I want delta H now. It was a good thing before. Let's make it a bad thing. Yes? A bad thing will be when this is positive. I subtract. Let's make the entropy a good thing. What's a good thing for entropy?
Positive.
So this overall will be what sign? Here. This will be negative. So I have a negative and I'm adding a positive to it. I want this to be minus. I need this to be spontaneous. Who needs to win this time? Does this win or does that win? The entropy has to win, yes? And when does this win? When this number as a whole multiplied by the temperature is a large number, yes? This needs to be bigger than that. How do I make this bigger than that? By doing what to the temperature? Increasing it. So spontaneous at high temperatures. Guys, ask a question.
What would this question look like in the test?
Just it was like there's like a bunch of pluses and minuses, but
that's right.
Do you just want us to understand when it's non-spontaneous, spontaneous? Different
no,
temperatures?
I'm gonna give you on the test. If the reaction is exothermic and the entropy is decreasing, when is this process going to become spontaneous? Hello. So. Question would look like this. I have something that is exothermic. I have a process that is exothermic. And the entropy. Is less than zero. When does this process become spontaneous? So exothermic means minus the entropy minus less than zero, which means it is a minus. So this is a positive. When does this become spontaneous? At low temperatures. When this number is small, low temperatures.
When this number is small? When entropy is small?
Yes. Not the entropy small. The entropy is the same number. The only thing you can change is the temperature. When the temperature is low. Yes or no? Mm-hmm. Ask another question. Ms. Vega, you have a question? You're falling asleep in my class. How do you like that? You want one like that on the test, don't you?
No.
Which combination do you want? Tell me a combination you find difficult. Hurry up.
Exothermic and entropy is less than zero.
No, we just did it. Okay, guys, let me give you the test back.